barriers.
Perfect and spotless one.
worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name.
For all that the Lord has done for us, we can worship and praise his holy name today. As we have come through this week of Thanksgiving, as we get ready to go to the Lord in prayer and present our needs, how many today would say, you know, God's been good to me this week, and you would just like to say thank you and give God praise and glory for it. Is there anybody here today?
Well, I want to praise the Lord.
Okay, praise the Lord.
Well, last week I gave a praise report about the job situation, and when I thought it could be better, what was going to be my previous employer came back with a counter offer that was really generous, and so I get to continue working with the same team that I've been working with, which is something I'm very happy about. But the Lord's really blessed us. I'm grateful to him today. Give him equal glory
for that. Praise the Lord. Guys out there just trying to get a job, you're turning them down. I tell you what, isn't that be great? Have to make a decision between jobs. Huh?
Kids made it home for Thanksgiving the first time in 16 years. We all been together, and they all had safe traveling mercies. We thank the Lord for that.
Yes, it is good to get together with family, even though sometimes you fuss and fight. That's what family's about, isn't it? I don't know about you, me and my sister, we fussed all the time when we were little, and we still fuss sometimes when we're older. But we had a good visit. I did see my sister a lot, but certainly glad to have them. Honestly, I don't even know who we are at this time, but we had a good time sitting around the table, acting stupid like we used to when we were little. So Mom during the meal said, this is what it used to be at every meal that we had around our house. It got crazy at times. It was just fun to have everybody back around the table again. Isn't it wonderful to know that one day we're going to get to heaven and we're going to gather around the table of God and we will never part again? And all those loved ones that we have known that have went on will be reunited. What a wonderful gathering that's going to be. I'll tell you what, that's what I'm waiting for. I'm telling you, Jesus is coming back, and I thank the Lord that I'm ready to meet him. I hope today there's really this place we can all say that same thing. Brother Troy, I would like for you to get a song ready here for just a minute. I know it's the Christmas season, but this is more of an Easter song that we sing at Easter, but it's just been on my heart. That song says, Because He Lives. I don't know if you have that one there, but when we come to the Lord today, everything we do, the prayer requests that we give, the reason we sing, it is all because of one reason. That's because Jesus is alive. If he was not alive, if he was dead and he was in the ground, there would be no reason to do what we do here today. But because Jesus is alive, we can take and we can worship and praise him today. How many of you today, as we were here, and say, Pastor, I've got a need that I need to make mention of, and you would just either signify it by speaking out or raise your hand and say, I've got a need that I'd like to just let the church know I have. Anyone here today? Yes. I mean, you know, God's still the healer of cancer.
Amen.
There's nothing beyond God's power and God's control today. We can have healing today because of what he did on the cross for us. Any others? Sister Stacy.
Well, first of all, she doesn't know I'm going to do this, but I'd ask a prayer for Sister Susan. Her back, she's been having a lot of trouble, and she was sharing with me last night. I hope she doesn't mind, but she's done all the usual things, and it's not getting any better. And so just pray that God would touch that problem, or at the very least bring to light what is the problem, so that an answer can be found for that. And then I've also been having a little problem with my back, which is new, so I'm going to be going to see somebody about that tomorrow. So I'm, of course, hoping for a quick, easy answer. But this morning, I have asthma, which usually does not bother me here at church when I'm singing, but I just had a little bronchospasm. And so I'm hoping not to go down the road I went down last year, where it got very, very severe. I've been dealing with some sinus.
if you have a need today, we're going to just come and believe, and we're going to anoint with oil. The Bible says, is there any sick among you? I'll call for the elders of the church and let them anoint with oil, let them pray the prayer of faith. And the Bible says that the Lord will raise them up. And so if you're here today, we still believe that there is prayer, that there is the ability to have people pray for and God to do the miraculous in their life. But the reason we can do that is because Jesus is alive. And that He is still moving, and that He is still working in people's lives. We had a pastor at the previous church, we pastored at Blue Ridge Assembly of God. We were talking to some people the other day, and they said they had a lady that came in one night, and she was having problems, and they began to pray for her. They didn't even know what the situation was. She was just up around the front of the altars, and they began to pray for her. And she said, Lord, help me see. Lord, help me see. Lord, help me see. And one of the ladies that was praying with her said, you know, I just thought in my mind that there's something that she's needing to have prayer for, that she can get vision and know what God wants to do in her life. And so I'm praying, Lord, just give her vision. Lord, just help her to see what you want to do in her life. And I didn't realize that the lady was blind. She had only been able to see maybe shadows of things, but she had been blind for so long. And about that time, she began to cry out, I can see, I can see, I can see. And you know what? I was talking to them the other day, and they said she is able now to see. She saw people she had never been able to see for years. Let me tell you something. We serve a miracle-working God. He is still the God of the impossible. He's the God of brain cancer. He's the God of back pain. He's the God of asthma. Whatever the situation is today, as we sing this song, Because He Lives, I'd like for you just to come and gather around the front. Even in this place today, God is able to do great things because He is here. When He is here, great things can happen. So as we sing this song, would you just come and let us pray with you and anoint you with oil and believe God with you. Because He lives, we can face tomorrow.
Because He lives, because He lives.
Just because. tomb of their God, may they worship, but I'm here to thank you, Lord, that today you are alive and that there is an empty tomb and that Jesus, you are at the right hand of God, that you have all power, you have all authority on earth and in heaven, and that Jesus, that at your name all things are possible today. Lord, we recognize that for these that have had pain in their back and in their body and they are suffering, that Jesus, you are the same God that walked the streets of Jerusalem and Judea bringing healing to people of God. You are the same God that is able to work in their bodies. Lord, I realize that many times the things that we face seem like impossible situations. And Lord, as we think about this child that has cancer in the brain, Lord, we realize that that is something that must absolutely bring fear to parents' hearts and lives today, recognizing that their child is facing this illness. But God, I pray that we would recognize that you are still the God that's greater than cancer. You're still the God that overcame death. And if you can overcome that, you can take it. You can overcome every situation that comes into our life. So Jesus, today I pray that you would be with that entire family. Lord, I pray that you would be with that young boy as he is going into that treatment room. Lord Jesus, that you would be with him. That Lord, even before they begin to run the IVs and they begin to do the chemotherapy and the radiation, that God, you would come on the scene and that you would do something. That when the doctors look at the x-rays, they will have to stand there astounded, recognizing that the only answer is that there is a God that heals. There has been something miraculous that has happened, and that Jesus, you would begin to do the work in that young man's body, that you would begin to raise him up. I pray that you would be with his parents, that Lord, you would give them emotional strength, Lord, that you would give them physical strength, and that Jesus, you would comfort their heart, Lord, and that they would recognize that you care for them today. You are our healer. You are the Lord who is our healer. And so, Lord, we stand on the authority of your word, recognizing that you said, I sent my word to heal their disease. Jesus, you come to be our healer. You come to be our Savior in the time of trouble. So, Jesus, we ask that you would work and that you would move in each and every one of these situations, that people's lungs would be cleared up and they would be able to breathe, and that Jesus, back pain would go and knee pain would go today. Lord, just show yourself to be mighty to save in our situations today. Lord, I pray that you would lead this church, and Lord, I pray that you would open up doors and opportunities for us that we cannot open. Lord, you said that you are able to open up doors that no man can shut. Lord, I pray that you would open up the doors of opportunity. Lord, I recognize that there are times that we need you, and you are the only one that can work for us. So God, we ask that you would work for us today in locating a building, Lord, and locating a permanent place. Lord, I've had my ideas, I've had my plans, but Jesus, today we pray that you would do a work. Lord, that you would open up the doors and that you would lead and that you would guide us. We have our plans, but God, I pray that you would direct our steps today, that you would give us wisdom and that you would give us the knowledge to know what we need to do. And Jesus, we give you the praise and the glory for hearing our prayers and answering them today. In your name we ask you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. He may be seated today. We are going to ask you this week to, I just feel led to do this, to take and set aside a meal that you would have, that you would be able to pray. We need God to give us direction. We need God to open up doors and give us wisdom on what to do in a building. You know that we had told you last week we thought we had located a building. We called the zoning department in Peculiar on Monday, and when we they told us that
due to zoning laws, we could not go into that building because there was a liquor store that was next door. We had to be within so many feet, 500 feet of that liquor store before we could have a building or have a church there. And he said the law was originally designed to help churches not have liquor stores come in next to them. But he said that law works in reverse as well. So we were not able to do that. And I will tell you, at this time, I don't have a clue of where we could go in Peculiar. But you know what? God does.
Yes, amen.
And or wherever he wants us to go, he can lead and he can guide us. We're asking just to you make it a matter of prayer that God would give us wisdom and in the direction that we need to go. And so I believe that if we pray, you know, who knows, maybe the liquor store will decide there's a better location and they'll move out. I don't know where they'd go, but probably wouldn't hurt Peculiar to have one less liquor store, honestly. Whatever God wants to do, we're open to that. So let's just pray that God would work and move in all of these situations that we need to. Obviously, we're trying to find something before the cold weather hits. We are now having to keep our equipment out in the cold. And so we got several thousand dollars worth of equipment that sits out. So when it's 10 degrees, it's out there 10 degrees as well. And so we are trying to find a place before the cold weather hits and gets real bad. So just make that a matter of prayer. God knows. There's no need of us to fret and worry about these things. Our God's in control, and we trust him with everything. And so when he speaks and he leads, we'll know it's the leading of the Lord. So just be in prayer with us this week as we are trying to get direction and find God's leading. We're going to ask the ushers to come at this time. We're going to wait on you for the Sunday morning tithes and offering. You know it is a joy to give unto the Lord. And so today as we give, let's give joyfully. Let's don't give, oh man, don't be like my kids. Hang with me, dear. It's cute. And the person I'm speaking of is not even standing up here. But I remember a few years ago, you know, we're talking, it's the Christmas season. And I remember 2 or 3 years ago, I had decided I was going to go deer hunting. And I woke up at 3:30 in the morning and I was driving down the road. And as I was driving down the road right outside of Clinton, Missouri, I looked up and a doe come across the road. And the very first thought that went through my mind is, I better be careful because there's probably a buck right behind her, and I no more got that out of my mind saying that. I looked it up, and here was a buck who thought he was a ram, and he turned around and he ran directly into my truck and hit the grill of my truck and tore the entire driver's side out of my truck. Did almost $5,000 worth of damage to my truck. I remember calling my wife that morning, and I told her, I said, honey, I said, got some good news and I got some bad news. And she said, well, what's the good news? I said, I killed the biggest deer of my life. And she said, you couldn't have because the sun's not up. And I said, the bad news is I ran over it with the truck. And I said, I tore the whole driver's side out of the truck. Well, when the kids woke up that morning, my wife got them all around and she said, well, your daddy got a big deer today. And they said, he did. And she said, yeah. I said, he hit it with the truck. And Jordan was sitting around the table, and he was quite a few years younger, and he goes, great, there goes Christmas. Now, let me tell you something. As we give to the Lord, let's give joyfully. And let's not think about, there goes another Christmas present I'm not going to get. You want to know something? This season's all about him anyway.
Amen.
We'll just consider this our gifts to Jesus today.
Yes.
And the Lord is going to bless us as we give. Lord, we thank you today that we have the ability to give. Lord, this is not done because we have to. Jesus, this is done because we love you. Lord, you who don't deserve a tenth, you deserve everything. And so, Jesus, this is just a little bit that we can give back to you, giving praise, glory, and honor for all that you do for us. And we give it with a heart of gratitude unto you. And we ask that you would take our offerings and that, Lord, it would be used for the kingdom of God. In your name we ask it, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Singers today. How many of you know that real light is what the world is really searching for?
Right on.
They are trying to find something that will give them peace. They are trying to find something that will give them comfort. They are trying to find something that makes it worth waking up in the morning. And they're trying it with every means possible. Some are trying it with Jim Beam and Jack Daniels. Some are trying it with methamphetamines and drugs. Some are trying it by find more than they've ever had before, but the fact of the matter is that things will not bring you peace. People can, and relationships cannot give you what you need in this life. The only thing that will give you peace, love, and hope for this world that you live in is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we hope that if you leave this place, that you will know that there is a relationship with Jesus that needs to be. Before I get ready to speak, Sister Susan is going to come, and she's just going to make a real quick announcement, and then we will dismiss the children to be dismiss the children's church.
Good morning. Good morning. Can I ask her hello? Good morning.
Good morning.
We are going to our ladies' Christmas event. It is going to be Christmas at Resurrection, at Church of the Resurrection, in Lima, Kansas, and that's Friday, December 12th at 7:30, and I think I put in the bulletin 7 o'clock. It's actually 7:30. The cost is $17 a ticket. I have the tickets today. I know that I've had several ladies already tell me they wanted to go, so make sure you see me today after church. If you want to go, we'll put your name on there, give you your ticket, and you can either give me the money today, or you can give it next week, and on your tithing envelope, write Christmas and the $17, and we'll know that that goes towards the ticket. But we are going to go have a great time. We're going to see a musical. They said there's over 300 actors, singers, performers in this production. It's supposed to be the best Christmas production in Kansas City, and I'm really excited. I'm taking my daughter. She's going, hang on. So anyway, it's for our ladies. We want to go out, have fun. We may go out afterwards, maybe get some coffee or a bite to eat. But that is our Christmas event for 2014.
We're also looking at putting together we're not normally have a program because, as you can see, when we come in on Sunday morning, we don't have time to put up sets and things like that. But we have some very talented young people in the church. We have some people that sing, and we're going to put together something with some Christmas carols and Christmas songs and all of that on the Sunday before Christmas. And so come out and be a part of that. And if you play an instrument, let us know. We've got instruments, music for just about every instrument out there, and you can be a part of that. And we just want to do something a little special on that Sunday. And so you be a part of that. I think that God will bless us as we use our talents together. We're going to dismiss everybody to go to Kids Church. Sister Susan has got some great things planned over there today. And I watched the videos. I'll tell you what, maybe we've got to show them around here before I preach. And I think maybe that gets all... He is all laughing and stirred up. If you got your Bibles, let's turn to James chapter 2. Now, this is not going to be a message that's probably going to have everyone shouting today. I understand that. But I think it's one that we need to hear, especially in light of many of the events that we have been seeing on the news and the things that are going on around our world, especially in St. Louis. What I'm going to be talking about today is non-partial relationships. All these sermons that I've been preaching is vital signs of real life. You know, there's a lot of people out there that say they have a relationship with Jesus Christ, but if we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, there ought to be some things that we can look at in people's lives and recognize that they're different than the rest of the world. And it is important for us to realize that when we come to Jesus, that we accept Christ as our Savior, we're a long way from perfect. How many perfect people do I have in here today? That's what I thought. There is no perfect people in here. We are all developing a life that is more like Jesus each and every day. And there's some things that we don't really have quite control of yet. Last week we talked about being doers of the word. It is interesting that James, at the beginning of the book, he's talking about going through tribulations and temptations and trials. And then last week he begins to talk about being a doer of the word. And he's setting them up for the fact that if you're going to be a doer of the word, that you're going to be the kind of individual, and he talked about that nasty thing, the tongue, last week, that we would have control of our tongue, and that our words and our speech would be edifying to the Lord, that would be one thing that would be showing that we have a relationship with Christ. But this week, he comes to the fact that if we're going to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we will be non-impartial to people and the way they are. We will be accepting of them. And I think sometimes in the church, we can get to a place where we think that we are spiritually mature in a lot of areas. There may be a few areas that we're lacking, but there's one area that I think that we can all improve on, and that is being impartial and practicing an impartial attitude. I have to deal with this myself. So if you sit here and think the pastor's preaching to just us today, no, I'm preaching to me as well. We need to realize what Christ wants us to be in our, how Christ wants us to live our lives. And in James chapter 2, verse 1, we begin reading, it says, "My dear brothers and sisters, how can you claim to have faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ if you favor some people over others?" How many of you ever grew up, who grew up in a family where your parents liked the other kids better than you? Got one in the back. She's honest. She said, "Yeah, my parents, like, I have one couple here that's raised their hands." You know, sometimes we can feel like that there's somebody that is liked more than us.
Being a parent, I know that I do my best to be impartial. But sometimes that doesn't always work out. It seems that no matter how hard I try, one thinks that the other one's getting special favors. It's really not that way, but it's not intended to be that way, but sometimes it can come across that way. And James says here, brothers and sisters, how can you claim to have faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ if you favor some people over the others? For example, and he gives us an example here, he says, suppose someone comes into your meeting, comes into the church, dressed in fancy clothes and expensive jewelry, and another comes in who is poor and dressed in dirty clothes. If you give special attention and a good seat to the rich person, but you say to the poor one, you stand over there or else sit on the floor, well, doesn't this discrimination show that your judgments are guided by evil motives? Listen to me, dear brothers and sisters. Hasn't God chosen the poor in this world to be rich in faith? Aren't they the ones who will inherit the kingdom? He promised to those who love him. But you dishonor the poor. Isn't the rich who oppress you and drag you into court? Aren't they the ones who slander Jesus Christ, whose noble name you bear? Yes, indeed, it is good when you obey the royal law found in the scriptures. Love your neighbor as yourself, but you favor some people over others. You are committing a sin. You are guilty of breaking the law. For the person who keeps all the law except one is guilty as the person who has broken. For the person who keeps all the laws, I'm going to have to raise that up, I forgot my glasses. Except one is as guilty as the person who has broken all of God's laws. For the same God who said, you must not commit adultery, also said, you must not murder. So if you murder somebody but do not commit adultery, you have still broken the law. And then in verse 12 he says, so whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. There will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others, but if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you. When we look at this passage of scripture, we see that favoritism is sin. James comes right out and says it. He says favoritism is sin. Now in this passage of scripture, the favoritism that he is speaking about is a favoritism that is based upon class, social class, the rich and the poor, financial class. And he's saying, listen, if you're giving special attention to a man or a woman who has big money coming into the church, but you take a poor person and you put them over in a place where no one will see them, he says, this is sin. But you know, it is possible, even in churches today, that we show favoritism to people based upon what they have to offer us. That we can say, well, a person that has lots of money, they are more important. And if we don't do things the way that they want it done, that it's possible they may leave the church. They may not stay in the church. But in the church and the body of Christ, we have been made one through the blood of Jesus Christ. And therefore, there is neither rich nor poor. There is only redeemed and sanctified. There's redeemed, sanctified, and sinner. And you know what? I think that even if a sinner comes into the church of Jesus Christ, that they should be able to feel the love of God extended to them. Because God loves the sinner. He loves the sinner as much as he loves the saint. I can prove that to you because in the parable of the lost sheep, he left the 99 and he went after the one that was lost. So when we come to church, if we have somebody that comes into the church, we ought to look at them. And if they come in and they walked off the street and they've been living under a bridge and maybe they don't look so good, they don't smell so good, it should be us that opens up our arms and goes to them and accepts them for who they are, where they are, and show and extend the love of Jesus to them. It doesn't matter whether we're rich and poor in the kingdom of God. It only depends if we're saved or we're not saved. Because God does not look at the outward appearance,
But God looks at the heart. Remember the story of Samuel when God sent him to anoint a king for Israel. And he sent him to the house of Jesse. He went through all of the sons of Jesse, and the Lord had told him, almost all of the sons of Jesse, and he saw men that looked good to him. They would make great kings to lead Israel. And he said, surely this must be the one that the Lord has chosen. And the Lord said, no, not this one. And finally he went through all the boys in the house. And he looked around and he said, do you have any other sons? And Jesse says, well, I got one left. But he's just the youngest, and said he's the strongest. He's the ruddy one, the Bible says. He's the red-headed kid out in the field. He said, that's the only one I got left. And Samuel's looking around, and he's going, well, that's the only one left that I haven't seen. Go get him. You see, God chose somebody that Samuel wouldn't have chosen. But see, God sees things that you and I will never see. You may work with somebody. You may have a neighbor that you think is just totally beyond help. But God may see something different in the person you work with that comes in, and they're swearing and they're telling the dirty jokes and they're messing around on their wives or their girlfriends or their husband, and you're sitting here going, there's absolutely nothing to do with them, because every weekend they go out after work and they spend their entire paycheck getting wasted and spending all of their money on alcohol and drugs, and there's nothing that God can ever do with them. But let me tell you something. You're looking at the outward appearance. You're looking at what God's not looking at. And when God sees that person, the only thing that God sees in a person is their soul. And no matter where you go on planet Earth, a soul is a soul. And God loves each and every one of us the same. And if there is a soul that is lost, He is reaching out to them saying, I want to love them. I want them.